So finally, the Raptor engine flaw apparently has been fixed, so that hopefully Starhopper hopping tests can begin in the not-too-distant future. The Texas Starship is also progressing further. This, of course, means that Elon's Starship presentation maybe still could take place by the end of July, this luck.
On the NASA Artemis side of things, we could recently witness the launch abort test of the Orion capsule. Then we got a super interesting shot from the Longjiang 2 orbiter, currently orbiting the moon and making an astounding photograph of a solar eclipse as viewed from the moon. And of course, even more news on this week's episode of Space News. So now it finally seems as if a major problem that had caused the delays of Starhopper's hopping tests time and time again has been finally overcome in the Raptor engine. As we know, all physical objects made from solid materials can vibrate. Now, depending on material properties, there is at least one frequency where the vibrations constructively interfere, meaning they get stronger when an external force is applied with the right frequency. This then is a so-called resonance frequency of the system. There can be, of course, multiple resonance frequencies. So now the Raptor engine apparently had a resonance frequency at around 600 Hz, meaning that when the engine was fired up, the external force caused by the very fast ejection of material from the engine caused the vibrations to get stronger and stronger. If these vibrations are not gotten under control, we speak of a so-called resonance catastrophe, where the whole physical object is destroyed. This could be impressively seen in the case of the Tacoma Narrows Bridge in 1940, where such a resonance catastrophe took place. So bridge and skyscraper engineers have to be absolutely aware of all the eigenfrequencies of a skyscraper or a bridge when designing them.
So this resonance problem apparently has been overcome by changing some critical elements of the engine with the goal to change this resonance frequency.
So the latest information we got is that the SN6 Raptor engine is actually being installed into Starhopper right now. And what's more, Elon is apparently aiming for the first hopping test by next week Tuesday, as indicated by this tweet. That's some exciting news.
At the same time, work on the two orbital starships is progressing further, with the Texas Starship further taking up shape. A Twitter user named Roger Holt shows a picture of how the currently assembled pieces of Starship would look when put into the finished Starship prototype. So we can see that not too much is missing anymore. Of course, the interior work, plumbing, avionics, etc. will have to be installed too. So the Starship is far from finished, but still it's nice to see this beast progressing. So there's still hope for the full Starship presentation by Elon taking place by the end of July. Even though we think that August is more likely. You know, Elon time. But it will be awesome in any case. On the NASA side of things, the launch abort system of the Orion capsule was successfully tested on the 2nd of July. 50 seconds after liftoff, controllers activated the LAS at an altitude of nearly 9,500 meters and at a speed of Mach 1.3. The LAS used three sets of motors to pull the Orion capsule away from the booster. NASA's Orion program manager said at the post-launch briefing that a first look at the data from the test suggested it went well, although a full analysis of the data will take a couple of months. Everything we've seen so far looks great, he said.
The purpose of this test is to make sure that the Orion capsule would safely detach from SLS so that the astronauts would be able to land unharmed in the capsule in the case of a catastrophic disintegration of the SLS during launch. It's good to see some progress there, even though we still remain quite pessimistic that the Orion capsule will actually fly to the moon in 2024. If they really want to make it to the moon by 2024, this launch abort test should have taken place already quite a while ago. Oh, don't worry, we do believe that American astronauts will land on the moon by the mid-2020s. But they will not be brought there by SLS and Orion.
And then we'd also like to talk about the Chinese moon program, because we shouldn't forget that the Chinese do want to land people on the moon. probably in the early 2030s. The ultimate goal of the Chinese space program is, and they aren't even secretive about it, to land people on the moon. So meanwhile, the Chinese Longjiang 2 orbiter, a small microsatellite weighing only 47 kilograms, which was launched together with the Chang'e 4 mission back then in December 2018, made an astonishing picture of the Earth as seen from the moon orbit. What's so special about this picture is that we can see the shadow of the moon on the surface of the Earth. It's amazing to see a full solar eclipse from the perspective of the moon, a sight which hopefully we will soon be able to witness while standing on the surface of the moon ourselves and looking up to Earth.
So last time we were talking a bit more about the announcement of the Dragonfly mission to Titan, of which we are very excited. Currently, Dragonfly is scheduled to explore this fascinating world with its giant lakes of liquid hydrocarbons in 2034. But we were talking more about the characteristics of Titan than about the technical specifications of the Dragonfly drone. So this drone is basically a small octocopter, arranged with 8 propellers in 4x2 arrangement fashion, weighing around 420 kilograms in total.
The diameter of the drone would be around 3.5 meters, with each rotor having a 1 meter diameter. Now, how would this drone be powered? Solar cells are out of question. Titan is too far away from the sun, and on top, the atmosphere is very opaque, reducing the intensity of sunlight reaching the surface even more. Lithium-ion batteries? Well, we might get a small problem with recharging once it's empty. Also, it would be empty very, very fast at a surface temperature of 93 Kelvin and the drone weighing 420 kilograms. So the only real option here is a good old radioisotope thermoelectric generator. In simplified terms, this kind of battery functions by employing the heat generated by nuclear decay. The decay of plutonium-238 dioxide, in fact, and in turn using the thermoelectric effect to generate electricity with that waste heat.
The Mars rover Curiosity is, by the way, also powered by such a multi-mission radioisotope thermoelectric generator, or short MMRTG. So this battery would have an energy capacity of up to 14 kilowatt hours, yielding a constant power output on Titan of up to 70 watts. Now, this doesn't sound like much, and indeed it isn't much, so the drone couldn't fly around for days and days without pause. It would actually have to make lots of pauses and be able to fly for maybe 1 or 2 hours and then replenish the battery again. So the battery would of course replenish itself by new radioactive decay. That's why this type of battery is so interesting for space missions.
But still, a mission duration of a few years is envisioned. And even though the drone would have to rest quite often, and of course couldn't fly all the time, in a few years, many interesting discoveries will be made. There is much more to tell about the technical specifications of the Dragonfly drone, and what implications the mass of the drone and the MMRTG have on the total duration of the mission. But that will be part of a video, which we will entirely dedicate to this fascinating mission. So as I know you still think that Starship would be our best choice to land on the moon despite this new mission success of NASA.
Absolutely, 100%. I think Starship is a flying moon base and is absolutely superior to SLS and Orion. Absolutely superior. And you, what do you think? Who will land first on the moon?
The Chinese. Anyways, be sure to subscribe to our channel, because we are planning something really, really special for next week's 50th anniversary of Apollo 11.
That would be awesome.
See you next week then.
See you.